Hi everyone, good morning. Hope you had a good day of events last night and last day, yesterday. So, my presentation about licensing of games to publishers in Southeast Asia or mainly to publishers itself. So, I'm Robin, basically the International Business Director of AsiaSoft. So, my main priority will be game sourcing and game acquisition for the AsiaSoft group. So I've been doing mobile stuff since very early days when people started, SMS starting to get popular. And my focus is basically on Southeast Asia. So about AsiaSoft, we are one of the leading game publishers in Southeast Asia. We have been around for 15 years. And we had presence in 6 countries, over 600 staff published. Currently, we had about 33 games, but over the last 15 years, we had more than 100 games published and also been closed. So our user base in Southeast Asia is over 150 million registered. And we are public listed in Thailand. I think one of the first PC gaming company to be listed in Thailand. So next, just a quick overview of Southeast Asia. What's the market potential? So we are one region, but 11 countries. Focus is right now on just the key 6 countries. Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia. So we are actually very diversified with different languages, cultures, behavior, and also different likings. And mainly about Southeast Asia, we are basically East meeting West. So publishers from the East Asia side and publishers from the Western countries all are able to, I would say, conjure into the Southeast Asia. And this is how big we are. From We Are Social, basically we're about 637 million, but I think it's more than that. There's surely bound to be some unregistered user, people around. So mobile penetration rate, we are actually more than 100%. We are very active on social. There's over 150 million Facebook account. People view over 1 billion views of YouTube videos in Indonesia, etc. And we are a young region because over 70% of the population, or over 75% of the population, is less than age 35 and above. So there's very good growth potential in South Asia in the next coming 3 to 5 years or even 10 years. And actually, this is actually from research done last Q4 last year. So there's about 155, or basically should be about 160 million smartphones, physical smartphones in South Asia right now. So this is basically the potential of smartphone users that we have, and these are the potential group of users that will be actually accessing mobile games, mobile services on their phones. And if you look at the breakdown of the mobile OS share, basically Google Android has a bigger share. Overall, it's coming to about 70, while iPhone actually has about 20+% in the market. So key thing here is Android, thanks to China, they are producing all these cheap Android phones. Basically, in Southeast Asia, you can get an Android phone as cheap as $50. And also due to social media and all the games, entertainment services, pickup rate for usage on services on mobile is getting higher and higher. And that earlier was the breakdown of the phone. In terms of revenue-wise, just for games, actually, on the official stock, it's actually quite a balance, 50-50. So you can see that although like countries in Philippines or in Indonesia where Android has a significant volume, but in terms of the revenue, it's quite balanced out between the two. So this is due to segregation of the consumer base because Apple iPhone has its high price. It costs the same in Singapore or costs the same in Indonesia, still at a fixed global price. So that helps to segregate the user base, the high end and the mid and low end. And also, of course, payment-wise, those who are on iPhones, basically, high chance they own a credit card, which they can actually use to pay for in-app purchases, etc. So that's an overview, quick overview of Southeast Asia. So if you look at it, there's a very good growth potential upcoming in the next few years. So Next will be the key topic, licensing of games to publishers. This is more for actually developers and gaming companies who are interested to work with us, work with publishers to publish their game in different region or in South Asia. So licensing of game, actually it's more like a marriage between two parties. So it's not that it's not a customer and client relationship. Actually it's more like a marriage relationship. And for publishers, we actually face a very headache task because there are so many games out there in the market and we are basically like, we are only like choose a few to just launch. So we treat it very wholesomely, I would say, because once we found the right game, things work very well. If something goes wrong, I tell you, you end up in a divorce between two parties within a short while. So for publishers, it's like you are going on Tinder, you're just looking at a lot of profile. Wow, there's a lot of pretty girls, handsome guys. Well, actually, there's too many for us to choose. So for example, over a year, like last year, basically for me alone, I could have actually seen more than coming 1,000 games over a year period where developers from all over the place actually send their information to us, say, hey, I got this game, please take a look, blah, 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 etc. So with 1,000 games, but my limitation is that we may be looking at 20, 30 games to publish. So there's a hit rate of like 1 to 10 or 1 to 1 is to 8. So basically, as I say, all looks good, but which one actually suits me most for my region? And for developers, I had this problem itself, is how usually they send the games to us, so they just throw me, hey, this is my test file, this is my game video, this is my PPT. But again, when we look at it, I say, oh, I got basically a few hundreds of this. How should I actually process it? And for a developer-wise, when you throw all this to a publisher, how well do you know the publisher will look at it? Or how do they choose? Do you really understand? Because there's a lot of startups that I encounter is, oh, wow, I just sent all this. Then the assumption is that, well, the publisher will like this, they will test it out. Sorry, I need to say it's not. So because there's too much competition for the game developers, you need to do something that captures our eye. So you need to know how we work. So how we test game, how we evaluate games, or what we are looking for in a game, etc. And you also need to know which region like what kind of games, what genre works well, because that helps you to prioritize which publisher you should actually work, try to attract. And as I say, developers throw everything to us, but do they know what we are looking for? So some publishers actually like have some preference like, oh, we prefer games with IPs. We prefer games that had good performance, good metrics, or even good gameplay, or allow us to do a lot of customization, etc. So developers usually don't list all this down, or actually don't show us what's the USP of the game, how it'll suit me. So for developers, I really encourage them to understand more and try to see it from our angle. So it increases their chance of their game being selected and being seen by us, or even being tested. Because for publishers, our testing process is actually quite tedious. There's a lot of evaluation metrics that we need to go through. For example, monetization, retention, acquisition, or viral aspects, or even the gameplay itself, whether the game mechanics actually suits what our region players are looking for. And for developers, you don't just actually prepare the information as what you see. So it's a common thing that if I develop the game, I'll feel that, well, my game is the best in the world, or my game can do this, do that. You need to be well prepared about how your game face up with other games, how you do a comparison, etc. And what's your game metrics, what's your game profile. Prepare all this well, put it in a nice order, and send it, show it to a publisher. if whether you're sending to them or even you're doing a pitching or even you're like having a meeting face to face with them, you've got basically a short time frame, like maybe 10, 15 minutes to capture their attention. So get all these done in order. That's key to meeting up with publishers. And since you got all this, how are you going to sell your game? Because imagine that you've got hundreds or thousands of competitors trying to fight for that one place. You need to also capture what attracts. And knocking on doors, basically a lot of developers just send, just do a mass sending. Hey, I got this great game, I sent to 100 publishers. Usually I tell you, if the mass sending, for the mass sending, the response is super low. Because we just see, put it aside, then our testing team or evaluation team will take a look. If it doesn't attract, we'll just throw it out. And usually we don't respond because there's too much response. So instead of knocking doors on everyone, game developer actually can try, best is try to do a research. Look at your game, where your game actually suits best, in which region or in which country. Then research the country, the publishers that are actually working in that region, and try to get meeting with them or try to know them and actually show them why your game actually suits the region that the publisher is based in. So that will actually give you a better priority, or the publisher will feel that this is something that is suitable for us. And for a game developer, you need to know about the publisher is, there are too many out there. If you have something that really attracts, and there's a lot of publishers are fighting for, you also need to study a publisher, which publisher can actually walk the talk and stay with you for a long run. So that's also a key thing. Some actually will just like, hey, I just take your game and publish, and if it doesn't work, let's call it off. So that damages your game and actually damages, actually creates a lot of negativity for you because you feel that, oh, my game can't work, etc. So it's like choosing a life partner. You need to find someone that suits you. It's not someone that attracts, say, hey, well, she's beautiful or he's handsome. I'll just stay with the person. Look in the inner beauty, I would say. And as I said, choose the one that suits your strategy best. Because as a game developer, you also have your own plans how you want to expand or publish your games and how you want to look in your business strategy for future development. So start, identify the publishers and actually talk to them more. Find out what's their strategy, how they can work for you, etc. Choosing the right one is very key, because once you got the right publisher to work with you, things can go very well. Maybe a game can go like 1 to 2 years. Some publishers that actually may not be suitable, within a 3 month period, you are out of the game. Basically, once they see metrics falling, this and that, they'll just, hey, we need to take it out. It's a cruel fact, but a lot of games actually get killed within a 3 month period because of maybe not getting a right partner that can work closely with you to see a long-term plan or long-term publishing results for your game. So the most flashy one may not be the most attractive. Don't get seduced by someone who's big, someone who's very powerful, say, hey, I like your game, give it to me. But after that, they don't really give you very good in-depth about what your game should be localized or customized, what your game should be adjusted to suit the region, etc. So these are considerations that you need to look into for a game developer. And even you found a developer or you partner with a developer, the road is definitely not smooth. There will be a lot of things that need to be changed and need to be localized, customized, or even adjusted before the game, before the publishing, or even after the publishing of the game. So a lot of developers say, oh, things will be smooth going, especially for indies, when it's actually, especially for the first game, all their thoughts will go wild, say, wow, I'll just do whatever I want. Oh, my plan, the game is going to be planned according as what I want. sad to say, that's not the fact. Because publishers will also tell you what to do and how to steer the game to suit the region. So don't get too upset when, let's say, a publisher say, hey, you need to do a lot of changes here and there. Need to accept the fact that all these customizations are done for the well-being of the game, for the well-being of getting good results in the in the region or country. And coming back again, think again, whether it's the most suitable partner. What's their strategy for the game? Are they a long-term partner? Or someone with, do they have track record, good track records where games are done well, and what's their actually kill rate? Because some publishers like could have done 10 games, killed 9 games, so high chance that you'll end up as the 9, within the 9 games. And who has the best initial business terms may not be the best long-term, business strategy for the for the developer or for the game. So it depends on internal how you or the game developer would want to see or reap in the long run. And for publishers like us, basically when we basically sign a game or partner a game, we are ready to make the commitment because internally we'll look at the game, we'll be able to factor, hey, okay, I can do this when. So we are ready to make the commitment. The developer also need to put in the commitment. It's not that, hey, I sign, hey, let's put one side. I got something else to do. I'll come back to you 6 months later. Sorry, we'll walk away. So it needs to be both sides need to be committed to make the game a success. And for developers, you need to understand your partner, how they work and how they strategize. You need to talk more to them because I also see a lot of developers when they license games to a publishers, they don't actually talk or actually discuss more. They just take in, hey, publishers tell me do this, I do this. Have more interaction so you understand why all these are needed. And it gives you, it reduces all the tension or all the friction between during customization or changes to the game itself. And learn from our partners. Publishers, we basically had a lot of experience, we've seen a lot, we understand the market much better than actually a game developer. Learn from them how things work in the market, and you can see how your game will be able to make adjustment to suit the publisher's region or the country or even on a global basis. And key thing here, find your right partner, you have a happy future. Wrong partner-wise, I tell you, you'll be end up in a divorce within a short period. And that's very damaging for both parties, I would say. And actually, summing up, so it's a reality check. As I say, only a handful will get selected. So even if you feel or you do you test the game with friends or within the social circle that, oh, your game is good, etc., we may not pick it up because it may not be what we are looking at. Because we have our business strategy, we know what kind of game we want what kind of game that the market wants. So if you have a wonderful, very attractive puzzle game or casual game or RPG game, we may not even want to pick it up because it does not suit us. Competition is very fierce. As I said, last year I've seen over 1,000 games. So how can you emerge out of the 1,000 games to come to be selected? And if your game don't get selected or picked up by a publisher, you need to review and see what went wrong. Is your game actually do not suit the market, or something is not? You did not do well in the presentation, the information being presented to publishers, etc. So review and check with publisher, get some insight from them, and you can improve it. And if you try a lot of publishers, and all the publishers tell you that, hey, this game can't work, whichever region or whatever, you need to make a call. Actually, you need to dare to scrap and drop the game, or dare to scrap and change the whole game plan. Because some developers we've seen, I've seen some developers, we actually told them this game will not work. They came back with the same game 1 year later and say, hey, there's no difference. So some are very insistent. You need to listen to us when we tell you that, hey, it's past or the market do not like this game. Then you need to look in the gate. And one thing, for game developers or gaming companies, look into building games for long term, not just build games to sell to publishers. Basically, we hate that. Because when you sell a game to us, we know that your plan is only a 3 months or 4 months plan. We're going to kick you out of the door. Because we always look at a long-term basis, at least 1 to 3 years basis, so that we can actually have good returns for both parties. So we are looking at games that actually build games and for the long term, and not games that are just reskinning something, selling to us, and after that go off within the next 3 to 6 months. we've seen that a lot from China. A lot there was so much mass production of games. Basically, same genre, same thing, all reskin, selling again. Then anyone pick it up. 3 months later, they say, "Oh, so sorry, we are not going to support the game." Then they just walk away. And the thing is, if your game don't get selected or get selected, don't daydream too much. So if you get selected, don't think that, "Oh, I'm at the top of the world. I'm going to be the next Supercell. I'm going to be the next Flappy Bird for casual games." So sorry, that is like one in maybe 50,000 right now that you can get a hit, because competition is too instant. Competition is very fierce for publishers, so we need to get things very noticed for all the games that we launch. So any games that actually out of the blue hit the top chart actually is like winning a lottery. So basically, these are the things that a game developer or game developers need to look into when they are actually talking or trying to work with publishers itself. And for publisher point of view, please help us. We need information more proper, so it's easier for us to review. So that's all for my presentation. This is my contact information. So if you need to, if you have games interested in Southeast Asia region, you can contact me.
At the moment. Well, I've got one for you, David. I wanted to ask you, how do you decide what games are suitable for publishing in the Southeast Asian market? What kinds of things do you look for from a developer?
For Southeast Asia market, basically, I think we look at what's popular on the App Store. We look at what other publishers are releasing and what the trends that are upcoming. And at the same time, we also look at what are the games out in the market, what developers are developing. So, for example, like towards late last year, there was so much action RPG games. So with the bulk of our action RPG games, so we'll know that, Q1 this year, there'll be full of action RPG. So do we want to go into the intense battle? Or if we're going to release action RPG games, How can I, from my publisher point of view, get all the attention, or how do I get the best action RPG to compete with the rest? So there are quite a number of things, external factors on the development side, internal factors on our market demands, and also other things that actually made up, and from there, basically we try to understand what the market wants, and also consumer behavior. Whether we are seeing any drop in certain genre or etc., and whether we need to pick up from there or not.
Are you able to share with us any trends that you see coming up or that you've seen in just recent past?
Okay, for Southeast Asia, I think it's still very RPG-based games. Key thing here is RPG games in Southeast Asia do capture better revenues. If you look at all the official App Store chart across all the key 6 countries, RPG games capture like basically 70% of the top 10 or top 20. So that is a trend that's going to be continuing for the next, at least this and next quarter.
Hi, thanks for the talk. I wanted to ask, do you recommend that developers that are making games for things like the Apple Watch, for example, should they seek a publisher in Southeast Asia, or do you think the number of units sold is too small in the region to be worth it?
Okay, for wearable devices like Apple Watch or even like those Android watches from Samsung and LG, the circulation right now in Southeast Asia is very low. And secondly, from my personal perspective is this, the wearables actually perform a very different function and not really suitable for entertainment or gaming right now. So I heard of companies that are trying to develop games for Apple Watches. It actually fluttered out after a while because they couldn't see the demand pick up. And even from the number of watches, let's say Apple Watch been sold, it's still actually quite a small volume. So personally, I would say not advisable to look into that.
Thank you very much, David.
Okay, thank you.
Please join me in thanking David.